to Mark.
Jesus said to his disciples, "Return once more to Jerusalem." As we were walking in the temple area, the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders approached him, said to him, "By what authority are you doing these things? Or who gave you this authority to do them?" Jesus said to them, "I ask you a question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Was John's baptism of heavenly or human origin? Answer me." They discussed this among themselves and said, "If we were to say of heavenly origin, he will say, 'Then why do you not believe him?' But shall we say of human origin?" They feared the crowd, for they all thought John really was a prophet. So they said to Jesus in reply, "We do not know." Then Jesus said to them, "Neither shall I tell you by what authority I do these things." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. We are all in this together. Throughout this year and a half, you have heard that many times and have lived it. We are all in this together. But sometimes we were apart, forced apart, alone. He was the loneliest man in the world. That was his nickname. The astronaut Michael Collins died at the age of 90 last month. Apollo 11's mission to the moon happened in July of 1969, and I had just turned 9 years old the month before. And I remember watching with my family when the other astronauts walked on the moon, Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. But Michael Collins was not with them. He stayed in the command module, and I felt sorry for him because he did not get to walk on the moon. I thought at that time, couldn't they have just taken turns? You know, you go and then I go, you know? Remember, I just turned 9. Michael Collins was just one of 7 people in the world to be alone in orbit on the far side of the moon, completely isolated from all humanity and all communications cut off, blocked by the moon itself. But he did not feel like that. He wrote in his book, Carrying the Fire, "I don't mean to deny a feeling of solitude," he said. "It is there, reinforced by the fact that radio contact with the earth abruptly cuts off at the instant I disappeared behind the moon. I am alone now, truly alone, and completely isolated from all known life. I am it. If I count were to taken, the score would be 3 billion plus 2 over on the other side of the moon, and 1 plus God only knows what on this side. Outside my window, I could see stars, and that is all. Where I know the moon to be, there is simply a black void. The moon's presence is defined solely by the absence of stars." He compares the sensation of being alone in that little boat, like being alone in that little boat in the middle of the Pacific Ocean in pitch black night. Also on that Apollo trip, when the astronauts landed the Eagle on the surface of the moon, but before they stepped out and walked on the moon, Buzz Aldrin held a simple communion service with bread and wine. As Buzz Aldrin said, I poured the wine into the chalice our church had given me, and the 1/6 gravity of the moon. The wine curled slowly and gracefully up the side of the cup. He used the same chapter in the Gospel of John we would have heard today. He recited, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, because without me, you can do nothing. Apollo 11's mission to the moon carried with it the power to unite the world for a time, while even mindful of the time of Michael Collins' aloneness. The gospel we had heard today was a chapter that Jesus speaks about remaining united with God and the Lord, and how we are united with each other. Our first and second reading both speak about God's action in the world, the past, the present, and the future. Recalling God's creation, God being revealed in his works. Class of 2021, we pray that you have come to know God in a deeper way through your studies, through your questions, and your work at Charleston Catholic. And you have fulfilled the prayer of St. Paul in our second reading. May the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation, resulting in knowledge of him. And that you are able to fulfill the motto of our school's coats of arms, seeking knowledge in the light of Christ. Again, the gospel we had heard speaks about remaining in love with our God and with one another. For Jesus tells us, remain in love and love the way God loves. And we are to remain in love, remain with God, and in doing so, we will bear fruit. That one fruit is joy. But apart from Jesus, apart from God, we can do nothing. Michael Collins gave us a description of being isolated on earth, that little boat in the middle of the ocean. We know that feeling. We know what it's like to be cut off, sometimes from God, Christ, and each other. Many times through either laziness or sin, no longer we remain in the Lord's love, not staying connected with the Lord through our prayer life. We may feel that we are on the other side of the moon, out of contact, without the warmth of the sun, S-U-N and S-O-N. May feel we're adrift. By being cut off, we cannot bear good fruit or experience the joy offered. We all know that experience because of the pandemic. The pandemic has sadly required us for a time to be physically disconnected with each other. No gathering, no sitting down and catching up, no embracing. We are slowly and safely returning. But we are also aware that there are still in many parts of the world, the pandemic is very far from over. Keep them in mind. Many are suffering, particularly the people of India. Don't forget them. Class of 2021, you have been through a most challenging time, one that you always remember, your last year during this pandemic. We pray that you will recall your need to be connected to others. We pray that you are able to see many powerful ways selfless love of others occurred. The principals, the staff, your teachers, your classmates, your parents, and friends. I pray that you learn well from them, but also that you learn about the selfishness of others. they did not remain in love. Learn from them as well. I also pray you recognize your need to remain rooted in your faith, in a God who loves you, and in Jesus who came to reveal the depth of that love. Remain in love. Remain in God's love. May you recall God's love in your past, experience God's love in the present, and find God's love in your future. For God's love will bring you joy, lasting joy. Mindful of God's love and care for us, we bring to God our needs.
Our response will be, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for the church, for our bishop, Bishop Brennan, for our pastors, Father Don and Father Binu, for a commitment to truth, peace, and justice through education. Together, we pray to the Lord.
Lord.
In thanksgiving for our education, particularly for our teachers at Charleston Catholic, we pray for students everywhere, especially for those for whom a quality education may not be readily available. Together, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In confusing times, may we be persistent and discerning in the pursuit of truth. Together, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we look to new beginnings in our lives, we are in solidarity with others who enter new chapters, for those who migrate and those seeking refuge. Together, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
In the midst of growth and change at Charleston Catholic, may the building project be fruitful, the incoming sixth grade be optimistic, the class of 2021 be strong leaders, and each of us move forward trusting in God's leadership and guidance. Together, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
As we transition, we pray for our parents, grandparents, brothers and sisters, and all those whose love and patience brought us here. For those here with us and those who cannot be, in thanksgiving and joy, together we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Remembering those we have lost, that they be held securely in God's loving embrace now and for all eternity, together we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those needs and concerns we hold quietly in our hearts, we lift them now. Together, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Loving God, all time belongs to you. With faith and trust in you, we offer you our needs. Ask that you grant them according to your design. For we make them in Christ's name. Amen.
Of the Lord who abide in you.
For my sisters and brothers, and my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
For the gifts you have bestowed, O Lord, we offer you the sacrifice of praise, humbly begging that what you have confirmed upon us in our unworthiness, we may give back to the glory of your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Up to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Eternal God. For you laid the foundations of the world and of a range of changing of times and seasons. You formed us in your own image and set humanity over the whole world in all its wonder, to rule in your name over all you have made and forever praise you in your mighty works, through Christ our Lord. And so with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration, we acclaim. Font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you in need of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking in the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Mark, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us, or we pray, that with Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, Blessed Apostles, and all the saints, pleased to you throughout the ages, you may merit to be sharers of eternal life. May praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. The Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. We live and reign forever and ever. Amen. Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other a sign of peace. For our communion rite, there will be two Eucharistic ministers on top, the level, on this side and on that side, okay? Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. O God, who have given to us as spiritual food the saving sacrament of your Son, which we offer you in thanksgiving, grant that, being strengthened by gifts of courage and joy, we may serve you more devoutly and be worthy of still further blessings. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Please stand. The Lord be with you. May God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Let us stay here in peace. Thanks be to God, yes.
We will now take just a few minutes to transition from our liturgy into our commencement ceremony. So, graduates, you may be seated, and we'll resume in just a few moments.
Hold on to me as we go. As we roll down this unfamiliar road, and although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
Thank you to all who were involved in the planning for the Baccalaureate Mass. We now move from Baccalaureate into the commencement portion of our ceremony. As you know, the academic program at Charleston Catholic is rigorous and demanding and establishes high expectations for all of our students. It requires effort and diligence from all. The salutatorian and valedictorian honorees have had to be particularly focused and dedicated to their schoolwork, beginning with their first days of ninth grade and continuing right up to their completion of classes and exams this week. This morning, we will honor and hear from the salutatorian and valedictorians. I am happy to introduce this year's salutatorian to you today. Please welcome Lindsay Carr.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you. I wish somebody would have told me how difficult it would be to find all of the right words for this speech. If I had known, I probably would have started a year ago. I had tried time and time again to write the perfect speech, to find the perfect wording that would accurately portray how much love and pride this class has brought me. The class of 2021 is so kind, so smart, so accomplished, and so driven that it deserves the perfect address. I struggled with the concept of what perfect really is. Is it a speech full of words that I looked up in a thesaurus? Should my words make all of you laugh, or should they make all of you cry? To me, perfection equals pressure. When I asked for advice from my family and friends, the most effective advice I received was, "Forget being funny, Lindsay, just be yourself." My initial response was, "So you're saying I'm not funny?" But then I realized that all of you know me, and if I try to be some other definition of perfect, I will just be reading words. And to me, this class deserves so much more than just words. You deserve an authentic and genuine expression of how grateful I am to have walked this journey with you. So what was at first a daunting task of creating a perfect graduation speech transformed into a relatively easy thank you note. First, I would be remiss if I did not recognize all of the parents and family members that have helped us get to this point. Thank you. From our first day in preschool to our last day of high school, you have all been there. I'm sure that parents, grandparents, and others who have raised us may have mixed emotions right now. You are happy that we are graduating and moving into the next chapter of our book, but you may also be a bit emotional that you may soon have a newly empty room in your home. I hope you can take comfort in a poem that my grandma introduced to my family as my parents sent off my older brother. It was her favorite poem, On Children, by Khalil Gibran. Your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but not from you. And though they are with you, yet they belong not to you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You may strive to be like them, but seek not to make them like you. For life goes not backward, nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children as living arrows are sent forth. The archer sees the mark upon the path of the infinite, and he bends you with his might, that his arrows may go swift and far. Let your bending in the archer's hand be for gladness. For even as he loves the arrow that flies, so he loves also the bow that is stable. I believe Gibran's bow is a symbol that includes not only our parents and family, but it also encompasses our teachers, coaches, and administrators who have enlightened us during our time in school. So I sincerely thank each of you for being that stable, flexible, and powerful bow that, with the assistance of the archer, has propelled us through our earliest years, our time in grade school and middle school, high school, and now into adulthood. You have helped send us toward our target that may not be clearly in sight, but that we trust is before us. You have prepared us to fly straight and true. You are responsible for where we are and where we are flying. Thank you. Thanks to each and every one of you. And for my classmates, my fellow arrows, trust that you have been made of the finest and strongest wood. Appreciate that you have been loosed from a bow made from all of those who have raised, taught, nurtured, and loved you. And know that the archer has sent us forward with a purpose, toward a target that, while we may not see it now, is what we are destined to strike. We need to trust ourselves, our bow, and our archer, and pursue the next adventure on which we are now all embarking with confidence, kindness, purpose, and determination. I cannot wait to follow each of your journeys, and I have no doubt that our special bond will endure. I love each of you, and I'm honored to have been given this opportunity to tell you once more before we graduate. Congratulations to the class of 2021. May you all find your future targets.
Thank you, Lindsay. Earning the title of valedictorian is not an easy feat. That's why this year is so remarkable. It gives me great pleasure to announce that this year we have not one, but three students who have shared the honor of earning the highest grade point average. They have maintained straight A's for their entire high school careers, quite an impressive achievement. Our first co-valedictorian is Emma Cimino.
Good morning. Last week in theology class, we were asked to write an original This I Believe life lesson, a short essay on what we thought to be the most important pieces of advice or things to live by. Me being only 17, I wasn't sure that I knew the true meaning of life or the secret to happiness and success, and frankly, I don't know that I ever will. But after some thought, and procrastination, of course, I decided to write mine about a quote that my mom used to say to me from the Taoist philosopher Chuang Tzu, reading, "Just when the caterpillar thought the world was over, it became a butterfly." After spending some time reflecting on the meaning of this quote, I discovered that it contained a multitude of messages in just 13 short words, many of which apply to our graduation here today. Throughout the past 18 years and leading up to this point, we have been caterpillars surrounded by a cocoon of support. Our parents, teachers, coaches, and peers have supported our endeavors and guided us through difficult decisions and challenging times. Whether it was Mrs. Griffith pumping up students with Eye of the Tiger before a math test in second period, or a parent cheering from the sidelines, we were enveloped by an overwhelming amount of assistance from people who genuinely cared about our success. Everything that we have accomplished in the past 4 years, state championships, academic awards, and scholarships to name a few, have served as the building blocks for the goals we will achieve in the future. The caterpillar thought life was over and then it became a butterfly. We know our lives are not over, but just beginning. As we walk across the room to receive our diplomas and move our tassels from the right to the left, we are undergoing metamorphosis and transitioning into the next stage of our lives. Although this change seems daunting, we are equipped with the tools necessary to thrive in the real world. I'm not going to stand up here and act like my GPA gives me some sort of extra wisdom or life experience, because I'm sure there are people here today wiser than I am. But I will say that the most important lesson I've learned from high school is that no one can do the work for you. A caterpillar may rely on its chrysalis for a period of time, but in the end, it must emerge into the world alone as a butterfly. With this new beginning comes a lot of responsibility. The new lives we are about to embark on will be different than anything we have experienced this far. We are going to meet new people, see new places, and learn, hopefully, lots of new things. College is a clean slate, a time for reinventing yourself and becoming the person you want to be. Remember, however, that no two butterflies are the same and that you are just as colorful as anyone else. Choose your environment and friends carefully, because every butterfly knows that a poor ecosystem can make life pretty challenging. If there's one thing that I've learned from my 7 years as a Charleston Catholic student, it's that in a world when you can do anything, work hard, and in a world when you can be anything, be kind. President John F. Kennedy once said that the sun does not always shine in West Virginia, but the people always do. I want to thank the Charleston Catholic community, teachers, administration, staff, coaches, and fellow students, along with our families and friends, for providing us with the opportunity and knowledge to be able to live up to Kennedy's words. Whether you are in Massachusetts or California, Florida, or right here in our home state, let's live up to Kennedy's statement and represent West Virginia well. Class of 2021, these past 4 years have been anything but easy, but I would not want to have spent them with anyone else. It's our time to burst out of the cocoon and shine, and there is not a single doubt in my mind that we will do great things. Thank you.
Thank you, Emma. Next, we welcome co-valedictorian Caitlin Keith.
Good morning, classmates of old and new, faculty and family. It is an honor to be standing here as one of the class of 2021's valedictorians. Today's a pretty big, exciting, and sad day. Today we move on from high school to a new adventure. I want to congratulate us all on getting this far, because that was a tough 4 years. We overcame a lot of hardships, research papers, growth spurts, or the lack thereof, Ms. Shirecki's English class, and I guess COVID. Despite all of this and the intense procrastination habits many of us developed, we've done it. We're graduating. It was only about 6 years ago that most of us made our very first tiring trek up to the third floor of this school building to the middle school area. It was only 4 years ago where we attended our first dances, listening to songs about crockpots and wild, wild thoughts, with the occasional dab thrown in there to spice things up. We've grown a lot over the past couple years. We've changed physically and intellectually, but don't worry, we haven't matured too much. Before I get any further, I'd like to take a moment to thank a few important and special people. First, teachers, those I had and those I didn't. You've molded us and taught us so much. Without you, diverting practically all your time and energy into us, who quite frequently take your efforts for granted, we'd never be where we are today, achieving what we are today. So truly, thank you. I'd also like to thank the administration, especially for all their excess work over the past year and a half. On top of their usual very busy schedules, They've had to adapt to the pandemic, finding ways to ensure everyone's safety and education while trying to make everyone happy on top of that. Every day, on top of their already hectic lives, they packed and served lunches to us, 400 plus kids. That's a long, hard job to undertake. So Mr. Villers, Mrs. Obel, Ms. Hoyer, Ms. France, Ms. Lovejoy, Ms. Herrick, the janitorial staff, Mrs. Lenahan, and all of the faculty, thank you so much for your hard work and dedication. When the events of last March and everything thereafter struck, everything changed. Schools online, we couldn't see each other, and many of us were a little frightened. However, we made it work. We survived, persevered, and came closer together as the true class, COVID class. Although we expected for our senior year, our whitewater rafting trip, final homecoming and winter waltz dances, final sports and drama seasons, and being able to see Mr. Welch's fashionable goatee, either was changed or didn't happen. Every possible curveball was thrown at us, and yet we still got through it. That's the message I want everyone here to take away from this long, boring, and should have already ended, but she just finds a way to keep on talking speech. I want this class to realize the power it holds if we set our minds to it. We come from a generation that is wholeheartedly ready to change the world, despite freaking out when we have to schedule our own doctor's appointments or make a phone call. We've learned how to improvise, adapt, and overcome, and we are extreme in all that we do and all that we are. So going forward, I expect to see from this class the very best that they can achieve. We've already achieved so much as a class, so it shouldn't be hard. We've made state championships, we've had foreign language medalists, we've won homecoming as juniors, and we've seen the skirt rule change from 2 inches to the fingertip, and that's a big accomplishment in of itself. So I look forward to seeing prolific artists, lawyers, doctors and writers, dancers and athletes, wrestlers, and more. I expect to see at least one person in this crowd change the world because I know my class and I know you can do it. Thank you, Charleston Catholic Class of 2021, for giving me the best 4 years yet. Thank you for giving me memories and experiences that I will hold with me until I die. As I wrap this up, I want you to remember two things. One, that you make your own path. Nothing is set in stone and will ever be set in stone for you. Your world is as malleable as Play-Doh, so have fun and be creative. Two, that the road will be tough ahead. You will have hardships and failures, but remember, as Ms. Zabłoński always told us, do your best and God will do the rest. Thank you.
Thank you, Caitlin. Finally, we hear from co-valedictorian Catherine Lakin.
It was once said that brevity is the soul of wit. Does not apply to this graduation, unfortunately. So you do have to hear one more speech. Before I begin, I would like to thank Mrs. Hoyer, the rest of the staff, and all of our teachers, especially those who came out of retirement or took on a much larger role than expected this year. Every single one of you went above and beyond to ensure our success as students and as people. I would also like to thank all the parents for feeding us, driving us to practices, providing us with an excellent education, forgot I could do that, and loving us. We didn't always make it easy, but you did it anyway, so thank you. When I was younger, I turned on the television to see a movie about a woman who falls overboard and suffers amnesia. You may be familiar with it. I didn't watch the whole thing, but that movie terrified me. You know how as a kid, you latch on to these irrational fears to get them stuck in your head? And that was one of mine. I'm going to fall off a boat and forget everything I know. And I couldn't bear the thought of forgetting a single moment of my life. The movie inspired my attempt to keep a journal, and I wrote down everything that happened to me every day, and then I gave up after a week. Remembering is hard work. My whole life seems to be tied up in the act of memorization, especially once I reached high school. What's the quadratic formula? What was the computer science homework? Which teachers always caught the non-uniform jackets? Where did I put my Sperry's? What were my lines? I had 2 lines in the whole play. What were they? All these worries were easily resolved. If I forgot homework, I could ask a classmate. If I forgot something that happened 2 years ago, somebody else who was there could pull it out of their memory and fill in the details I'd missed. I barely even realized how strange this collective memory was until I talked to new students who were baffled by the inside jokes and intimate history of the Charleston Catholic student body. The shared memory could be a double-edged sword. A slip of the tongue would be remembered years down the road. You may have wished to wipe the entirety of middle school from your mind, but your friends would not let you forget it. But mostly, it gave me comfort. There's a special kind of freedom in the act of forgetting and trusting others to remember for you. There's no one specific person in this class that's responsible for carrying on the legacy of our time here. Nobody is expecting you to remember all 720 days of high school. You'll be lucky if you can remember even 100. Luckily, there are about 60 other people in the world to remember the other 600 or so days for you. There's a little piece of memory stored in each of us, and no matter how far away we go, how many new people we may meet, or what change we may create, we all started here, together. We struggled to answer the questions on Yurecki's test, we screamed at the pep rally, we won homecoming twice in a row, we all complained about the temperature in Walker's class, and Shepler's class, and the gym, and you know, you get it. But we all started here together, and we made it. There are some of you I may never see again, but I won't forget you. And I'm counting on you not to forget me. Thank you. It is now my pleasure to introduce Senior Class President Emma Cimino, who will present our class gift.
Again. I think I speak for every senior when I say that this year has been anything but ordinary. After starting school 3 weeks late, at home, in front of a computer screen, we had no idea what the rest of the year would look like or which beloved senior traditions we would have to sacrifice. Nevertheless, we made it through, finding new ways to have fun while remaining COVID safe. Shout out to mass tailgates and bills before school. We feel for all those affected by the pandemic, and I am proud to announce that the class of 2021 would like to present the following gift to the Charleston Catholic community. A donation of tuition assistance in the amount of $4,000 to Charleston Catholic students whose families may be struggling financially due to the COVID-19 pandemic. We are glad to have something good come out of such a difficult year and wish only the best for the current high school students at Charleston Catholic and all those to come. Thank you.
On behalf of the faculty, staff, and Charleston Catholic community, I thank you for your most generous gift. Your donation to support tuition needs is just another example of how you look out for others with your kind spirits and good hearts. Thank you. Throughout the school year, we celebrate individual students and student groups on a daily basis for their academic, leadership, athletic, and personal achievements. Each of our graduates has earned our admiration for their many accomplishments in so many different areas. Beyond these publicly recognized honors, there are so many more that they have not shared. These unspoken accomplishments, which they share quietly with their families, also deserve congratulations and our moments of pride. On graduation day, it is our tradition to present a few school-specific awards as part of our commencement day celebrations. We start with the Matthew Pack Memorial Scholarship Award. The Matthew Pack Memorial Scholarship was established in 2015 in memory of Matthew Pack, a 2005 graduate of Charleston Catholic. Matthew found his home in California, where he pursued his passion for the outdoors. He died in an accident while rock climbing in 2011. Matt was always a free spirit, a voracious reader, and a true adventurer. His teachers remember his mischievous smile, his twinkling eyes, and his love of literature. He leaves behind a legacy of generosity to others, a love of children, and an adventurous spirit. Earlier this month, the seniors learned a little bit about Matt and wrote an essay describing how they demonstrate one of Matt's qualities in their daily lives. The essays were submitted anonymously to the Pack family, who read them and selected the one they felt best embodied Matt's spirit. I am pleased today to present the Matthew Pack Memorial Scholarship Award, a $3,500 cash award applied to the recipient's college expenses as a freshman. Emma Wirtz, please come forward. The Mary Ferretti Memorial Scholarship was established in 1999 in honor of Mary Ferretti of the Charleston Catholic Class of 2001, who died of cancer in February of 1999. Mary's life and death became part of the fabric of the Charleston Catholic community. Upon her death, her family established the Mary Ferretti Memorial Scholarship to celebrate her life and to assure that her spirit would live on and benefit our students now and in the future. This award recognizes a graduating senior who, in the opinion of faculty and staff, possesses Mary's wonderful personal attributes. Included in these character traits are a positive attitude and an ability to view obstacles as opportunities, a devotion to family and friends, an ability to work with younger children and to make them feel accepted and worthwhile, a willingness to be respectful, to look out for, and be kind to others, and an ability to enjoy each moment and recognize that the simple things are often the most important ones. The scholarship carries with it a $2,000 cash award that will be applied to the recipient's college expenses during the freshman year. Aiden Satterfield, please step forward. Community service is one of the cornerstones of Charleston Catholic High School and is a real-life embodiment of the school's philosophy and mission. Our seniors have demonstrated their spirit of service by contributing over 2,100 hours this year alone. These totals don't begin to reflect the countless hours the students didn't submit. And I think we can all agree service hours were harder to come by this year than many years, right? In 1993, we established the Les Cotto Thorner Memorial Award for Outstanding Community Service, recognizing Les Cotto Thorner, a minister to the young people at First Presbyterian Church for many years, and the father of two Charleston Catholic graduates. His was a spirit of compassion and selfless service. The award stays in the school with the award winner's name engraved on it as a reminder to each of us to give deeply of ourselves. Tonight, we recognize, or this morning, I guess, we recognize a senior who is a servant leader, going far beyond the requirements we expect of all of our seniors. Elizabeth Zax, please come forward. Finally, we present the Alumni Award. This award recognizes a graduating senior who epitomizes what Charleston Catholic is all about. In the opinion of school faculty and staff, this student has demonstrated loyalty toward and enthusiasm about Charleston Catholic, service to others, strength of character, and a dedication to achieving one's personal best and helping others achieve theirs. The recipient of this award has been a positive participant in life at Charleston Catholic, a leader among her peers. She is known for her friendly disposition and her overwhelming optimism. Her dedication to and for Charleston Catholic is undeniable. This young woman demonstrates a passion for supporting fellow students with a generous and giving spirit. She has been a leader among her peers since middle school. She shows respect for others and diligence in the classroom and in extracurricular activities. She reflects the strength and goodness of Charleston Catholic. Lindsay Carr, please come forward. And now we will move into the presentation of diplomas.
Robert Benjamin Armstead. James Walker Armstrong. Alexander Ivan Bailey. Ethan James Bailey. Evelyn K. Bastine. Alyssa Brooke Blevins. Sydney Ann Bowles. Parker Hampton Bragg. Tristan Lee Carpenter. Lindsay Virginia Carr. Hannah Rose Casey. Emma Elizabeth Semino. Anne Elizabeth Clevenger. Mason Cormany. Abigail Grace Cunningham. Aubrey Brooke Custer. Chase Michael Thomas Del Porto. Jenna Grace DeTemple. Robert Aaron Fink. Abigail Morgan Pfizer. Allison Elizabeth Gardner. Christina Isabella Gelmini. Lauren Elizabeth Gillespie. Isabella Marie Griffith. Celine Maria Hanna. Maria Cosentino Hopkins. Jacob Chasten Hufford. Grace Morgan Javens. Caitlin Marie Keith. Maria Celeste Kirshner Leon. Mobilaji Bancola Cranwinkle Omashore. Josie Michelle Kreitzer. Sophia Evelyn Curtin. Catherine Lakin. Matthew Michael Lewis. Grace Channing Litton. Sydney Davis Lowell. Alexandra Messia. Madeline Colette McCabe. John Patrick McCutcheon. Liam Patrick McKinley. Ian Frederick McMillan. Audrey Rose Miller. Anthony Michael Minardi. Trent Lee Newell. Amberly Wen. Michael Joseph Ojeda. Colleen Marie O'Leary. Aiden Patrick Paul. Hannah Parisa Rahin. Thomas Patrick Rennie. Elizabeth Ann Rushworth. Aiden Mackay Satterfield. Evan Hunter Sayer. William Edwin Chilton Shoemaker. Zion Ayers Suddeth. Will Kelly Swan. Eva Behringer Jans Tor. Nathan Tran. Emma Rose Wirtz. Andrew Paul Wright. Isaac Gage Young. Elizabeth Rebecca Zachs.
Well, here we are, one last time gathered as the class of 2021. Let's give them a round of applause. What a year it has been. You are the class who started with me in August of 2014. You were sixth graders my first year as principal. So in a way, we have grown up together. I never could have imagined what these 7 years would bring. I have been struck countless times this year by the beauty of your class and by the special way you hung in there through tough times. Over the last few weeks, I have done a lot of reminiscing about you and all you have been through to get to today. I think Maya Angelou said it best. We delight in the beauty of the butterfly, but rarely admit the changes it has gone through to achieve that beauty. I remember you as those little ones with wide eyes and big smiles as you started sixth grade. You had your first taste of homecoming events, lockers, and visiting the Civic Center to watch state basketball tournaments that year. Do you remember how big the school seemed from that perspective? I know Mr. Villers, Mrs. Linehan-Belcher, and a number of your teachers and parents remember your trip to Camp Modges in seventh grade. Could you forget Bosco Ball, the rope swing across the pond, and all the other adventures of camp? I remember your eighth grade moving up ceremony vividly. I remember talking to you about possibilities and all that lie ahead of you. I borrowed a quote from Casey Kasem and told you to keep your feet on the ground and keep reaching for the stars. I reminded you that the foundation had been laid. You knew how to study, you knew how to complete your assignments and turn them in, and that using your assignment notebook would be tremendously helpful. Through middle school, you changed and you grew as individuals as you began to identify your talents and your passions. At the end of eighth grade, I told you that high school would give you the opportunity to soar. And what heights you have reached. You have put in thousands of hours studying and writing papers and practicing math problems. It has paid off. The 64 of you have received 245 college acceptances to 115 institutions of higher learning all over the country. You will be attending 37 different schools from California to Florida to Massachusetts, with two of you enlisting to serve our country in the military. Your hard work has been rewarded with $6.5 million in merit-based scholarships. These are the scholarships you have earned for service, academics, athletics, and leadership over the last 7 years. When you started high school, 9th and 10th grade brought your first opportunity for AP classes and tests, in your first experience with new extracurricular opportunities. You jumped into ski club, drama club, quiz bowl, and the penman, to name just a few, and you made your mark on your athletic teams as well. During your years at CCHS, 32 of the 64 of you, that's 50%, have participated in drama, either on stage or behind the scenes, and that's without a single performance this year. You have been the driving force behind the Irish Coffee House and the Penman Literary Magazine. You have learned how to win and lose together. Over the course of your high school careers, your teams have made 35 state tournament appearances, resulting in 3 state championships and 3 runners-up. Keep in mind, many of our sports did not have the opportunity for state tournaments last year, and those numbers don't include the teams that are still currently playing. 9 members of your class, that's 14%, have signed to continue your athletic careers at the collegiate level. That's tremendous. Beyond those numbers, though, are the class and the sportsmanship that you all have demonstrated throughout your years. And that's what's impressed me the most. As ninth graders, you loved the freedom that came with the move from middle school to high school. You quickly earned a reputation as fierce competitors in the homecoming events, such as the loony lunches, the tug of war, and of course, the musical yoga mats. You have always stood out with your enthusiasm for your class and your competitive spirits. I also told you at your moving up ceremony in eighth grade that high school would not always be easy and that you would encounter challenges ahead. I had no idea, though, what your high school careers would bring. Your lives changed drastically on March 13th, 2020. Things were turned upside down, and we began an unprecedented journey together. You went from a life full of social interactions with your classmates and your teachers to a time of isolation and electronic communication. There was a tremendous learning curve for all of us, and to say it was difficult is an understatement. We hoped that we would make it through the last school year and that by fall, life would return to normal. However, this year has been far from normal. Your senior year at Charleston Catholic was a year like no other. Your teachers spent most of last summer trying to figure out how they could connect with you and teach you in a meaningful way if they were just seeing your faces on a computer screen. This year has been overwhelming and exhausting for them as well. They had to reimagine everything they have done previously as teachers and create lessons that would work if you were remote or if you were in person. But they told me time and time again, they would do whatever was in the best interest of you, their students. They continued to teach, to really teach, and to worry about your social and emotional needs, in addition to the physical health of our community. Please be sure that you thank your teachers for their extraordinary efforts. Let's give the teachers a round of applause. So we spent the first month of this school year learning remotely. What an experience that was. Remote learning was hard. I know how anxious you were to return to the classroom. I know that the workload was overwhelming, and I know that you missed each other. So finally, on Monday, October 5th, we came back to school. There, you faced more changes and more adjustments to things you have always known as a student at Charleston Catholic. When you came back in the fall, there were no clubs, no homecoming, no off-campus lunch, or even lunch with your friends, no lockers in the morning, no visiting teachers or extracurricular activities after school, and no fans at athletic events. But there were masks all the time, masks, and there was hand sanitizer everywhere. Despite those things, I remember what it was like seeing your eyes smile when you walked through school that morning in October to get your first squirt of hand sanitizer and to stand in line to get your temperature taken. The happiness you felt to be back at school, back with your classmates, and back into your routine was obvious. After all, you all are not just classmates. You are a family. You do not always get along, and there have been times when you didn't like each other. But you are a beautiful combination of actors and actresses, musicians, dancers, athletes, equestrians, academics, servant leaders, writers, and artists. Despite your differences, you look out for each other, and you stand up for one another. You are not afraid to talk to a teacher or an administrator if you are worried about a classmate. And when times are hard, you encircle one another and you hold each other up. You have grown up together. In fact, 77% of you have been together since sixth grade, 89% of you since middle school. You have become a family. I can tell you from the perspective of the adults at Charleston Catholic, faculty, staff, and administration, we are so grateful for you, for the class of 2021. Your positive spirit and good attitudes set the tone for the school year. Despite the negative, you embraced the opportunities and you took advantage of the chances to have some fun, even though they have been completely different than in the past. You've endured returns to remote learning, the interruption and postponement of sports seasons, COVID exposures, and calls and emails from me telling you you had to quarantine. Your homecoming week was in April, not September or October, and we crowned your homecoming king and queen in the commons instead of on the soccer field, and you cheered the experience. Instead of trips to Jimmy John's and Wendy's for lunch, your only off-campus lunches came in the form of walks to Haddad to have lunch outside this spring. You got dressed up and gathered for an outdoor formal dinner last week rather than your traditional prom in the commons. You celebrated your senior retreat, campfire, and project graduation all in one just in the last couple days. You are indeed a special group of people. Over the last months and years, you have endured many hardships together. Beyond those you endured together, you have faced personal challenges and heartaches as well. These obstacles have presented you with the opportunity to be angry and unhappy people. But that's not the choice you have made. As Maya Angelou said, you have found the beauty in the changes and the challenges you have encountered. You continue to wear smiles on your faces. You have touched my heart so many times this year, but especially in the last few weeks. I beam with pride when I think of you walking to the Civic Center for the basketball tournaments, singing the King of Glory as you walked, wearing your masks all the way for the duration of the walk and the games. I smile when I think of the tears in some of your eyes as you walked in and out on your last day of class this week. You bring joy to so many. My pride, though, does not touch that of those sitting around you today. Your parents and your families have been by your sides through the ups and downs of growing up. They love you with a depth that cannot be put into words, and they are proud beyond measure of all that you have accomplished. They made significant commitments of their time, talent, and treasure so you could attend Charleston Catholic, and we are so glad they did. We are grateful they shared you with us, and that your families became part of the CCHS family. Parents, please know that while your children are moving on, you are always welcome at CCHS. Please stop by and see us. Seniors, let's give your parents a hand, please. So in a few short minutes, you will join the ranks of the Charleston Catholic alumni. Remember the bond you have built with one another and the friendships you have nurtured at school will last far beyond the walls of the building at Virginia Street and Leon Sullivan. You will always have a home at Charleston Catholic. Stay in touch with us and with each other. Today, we celebrate the beauty of the class of 2021, and we thank God for all of the changes that have inspired that beauty. I leave you now with a traditional Irish blessing, my wish for you as you get ready for your next step. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face, and the rains fall soft upon your field. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. So with that, we are at the official part of the program now. The words I say to Father Higgs are the stamp of approval that you have earned from Charleston Catholic High School. Graduates, please stand. Father Higgs, I affirm to you that these students have met the graduation requirements for the state of West Virginia, the Diocese of Wheeling-Charleston, and Charleston Catholic High School. I present to you, for your approval, the class of 2021.
Mrs. Hoyer, on behalf of the Diocese of Wheeling-Charleston, I accept the candidates for graduation. Students, you may move your tassels.
Dear loving God, we ask for your almighty hand to be upon all those who graduate today. Bless their lives from this day on with goodness and love. Help them to stay true to their dreams, to use their gifts wisely, and to walk into the future with faith, hope, and great love. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I will now turn the floor over to our seniors.